following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Hi, everybody. Wait, let me get up a minute. 1 second. Yeah, I listen to Nicole Sandler. Is it time for the Nicole Sandler show? I forgot to turn the computer on. Let me just walk over here and I'll boot up my computer because I don't want... Oh, crap, I just... Never mind, it's okay, I got another one. Leave it there, the cat will get it. Got a little tune here, a little song to sing for you. That Nicole, she does something. She's really there.
Ah, yeah.
And does things.
I don't know what things.
Nicole Sandler Show, whatever it is.
Yeah, good morning and welcome to a Friday. It is the first day of May 2015. May Day, May Day. It is the day traditionally where workers unite. And so I guess it's fitting that yesterday was the day that Bernie Sanders, a champion of the people, of the working man and woman, announced his candidacy for the presidency of the United States. And it's exciting. And we're going to get to that in a minute. But before we do, I've got to indulge myself for a moment here and start off on a personal note. If you tuned in early for the pre-show music today, which it airs on the live stream at radioornot.com and on our TuneIn channel for about a half hour, give or take, prior to the show. And today were all songs dealing with the number 16. Ah, boy, I'm in trouble because my precious daughter turns 16 this week. And I say this week because I honestly don't know exactly what day is her birthday. Let me explain. 16 years ago this week, a woman in Kazakhstan gave birth to a little girl. She kept her and cared for her for about a month because it was in early June that this baby was left on a private doorstep in the city or in a small town near the city of Almaty, Kazakhstan. And it was about, somewhere in the neighborhood of 14, 15 months later that I received two photos in my email inbox, followed the next morning by an overnighted videotape. Yeah, see, this was in 2000, right? I got the referral, and if you're watching on YouTube, I'm showing these two pictures of this tiny little girl. And I didn't realize just how tiny she was until the second picture where you could see her holding some adult's hand, and you see just how tiny she is. This was, again, 2000, streaming media wasn't great, so they overnighted a videotape with this tiny little being, again, who was in an orphanage in Kazakhstan, waiting for someone to come and make her their daughter. And thus my journey to adopt my daughter, Allison. We took some pictures a few weeks ago of her holding up a picture of her shortly after we got home. We were, lived in California when I adopted Allison. It was December. We got home just before the end of the year, December 2000. So she was about a year and a half old at the time. And yeah, my baby turned 16 this weekend. It's incredible, just absolutely incredible. And so today, you know, when the adoption, the judge granted the adoption, and I had to go to the records office in this tiny town of Karakastek, where the orphanage was in Kazakhstan, where they had all the records. And nothing was computerized then, but there were books. The woman who was the clerk, I guess, who kept the birth records, was in this office. Again, this was late November, early December 2000, and there was no heat on in this building. We had to pay money for her to come in on a day that she wasn't going to come in on. And so she went looking for Allison's records, and behind her, the shelves were filled with binders, blue binders for the boys, pink binders for the girls. And they found her. Again, she was a foundling. She was left on a private doorstep. And then the people who lived there called the police. They then took Allison to the hospital, had her checked out, and then brought her to the baby home, the orphanage, where, you know, basically she lived for the next 15 months or 16 months until I came and brought her home. But so what they do over there, obviously her birth parents' names were unknown, so they make up names. So they made up, I forget even, I have it. Obviously, in the papers that I have saved for Allison somewhere. But they made up a name for her. They made up a name for the birth mother and birth father, but they were just that, made up names. And her birthday was just an estimate. Because when she was brought to the hospital, they estimated that she was about a month old. And so they gave her a birthday of May 1st. In fact, the name they gave her, it was Maigul, M-A-I-G-U-L, which the translation is Mayflower. So it's May Day. So when we were in the records office and they asked, you know, they crossed out the made up mother's name and wrote my name in above it, crossed out the father's name because I adopted her as a single mom. So there was no father. So that was left blank. And they asked what I was going to name her. They crossed out Maigul Matsikova, which I think was the made-up name they gave her, and put in Allison Paige Sandler. And then they asked, did I want to change the birth date? May 1st was just an estimate. And I thought, you know what? My mother's birthday was May 3rd. I lost my mom about a week shy of my 20th birthday. And Allison is actually named for both my parents, Allison for Alan, my father, Paige for Patricia, my mother. And I thought, but the best way I could honor my mom is give Allison my mother's birthday. So Allison's birthday is now officially May 3rd, but it could just as easily be today. So I told her she gets to, we get to celebrate her birth week. So anyway, we're celebrating today, especially. I'm thinking of that woman whose name I do not know, and there's no way to find her, but this woman who gave birth approximately 16 years ago today, took care of this little baby the best she could for about a month, and then left her on a doorstep, I'm sure hoping that the people who lived there would take this baby in, but I guess the universe had other plans. So I'm very grateful. I'm also grateful to this woman named Galia, who was my facilitator over in Kazakhstan. The agency I worked with turned out to be just a nightmare. Horrible, horrible people. I'm not going to get into that now. But the one thing, two things they did right. One was hiring Galia in Kazakhstan to help the families who went over there to adopt children. And the other, thing they did right was matching me up with my kid. So I'm very, very grateful for all of that today. So anyway, that's it. Happy birthday to my darling daughter. We will spend the, if you want to read our story, by the way, I do have it posted at radioornot.com. Under About Us, if you all the way to the right, you'll see About Us. And if there's a pull down menu there, and it has About Me, About Laffy, and then it says Nicole and Allison's adoption story. So you can read it there. I think there's even links to the video I produced back then, which is not great quality, but it works. Lots of pictures. And I promise you it'll make you cry. Tears of joy, but it will make you cry. So anyway, good weekend reading for you. So happy birthday to my darling daughter. We will be celebrating at the beach this weekend. We started this tradition a number of years ago. It's cheaper to rent a hotel room, especially in May in Florida, because it's now officially off season. So rooms are cheap. We found this little hole in the wall motel right on the sand in Pompano Beach, straight shot east from where I live. And it's like a timeshare place. So it's a two bedroom apartment we have right on the beach. She can have her friends, you know, girls sleep over. I can, you know, squirrel myself away in the second bedroom and not have to mess with them and wake up in the morning, walk out on the sand in a sunrise swim in the Atlantic Ocean. So it's relaxing for me as well. Anyway, if anyone wants to wish Allison a happy birthday, you can. I'll pass along any messages to her via my email or anything like that. All right. Now on to other important things. I mean, this is important, obviously. Yeah, I can't believe how my little girl has just grown up. She's almost all grown up. Anyway, she won't be grown up enough to vote in 2016. How's that for a segue? She'll graduate from high school in 2017, but she won't be able to vote for a president for a few years yet. However, today, as I was driving her to school, a story came on the news about Bernie Sanders announcing that he was running yesterday. And I looked at Alice and I said, "Now, Bernie Sanders, we love." And she said, "Okay." You know, she didn't care. But I tried to explain to her what's great about Bernie Sanders. And I'm feeling kind of defensive about Bernie right now. Here's the thing. Yesterday, the show ended and Bernie Sanders, a few minutes after 12 noon when the show ends, stood at a podium out on the Capitol lawn surrounded by some reporters and announced that he was going to run. Now, no script, not even any note cards. Bernie just speaking from the heart as he tends to do, right? Well, we carried that speech live. We ran about 15 minutes long yesterday because Bernie didn't stay there very long. In fact, he opened by saying, "I don't have a lot of time. I got to get back inside." And I'll just speak for a couple of minutes. We'll take a few questions and then I got to go. That's Bernie. You know, what you see is what you get. Well, a few minutes after, I look at my Twitter feed and there were some, you know, like me, it's like, "Fuck yeah, it's about time." You know, I titled yesterday's show, "Finally a Candidate I Can Believe In," right? But then I started seeing some really snarky tweets. And I took exception with some tweets from somebody who's been on this program. His name is Ian Millhiser. He's like the senior legal person at Think Progress. Now, Think Progress used to be much better than it is now. The Center for American Progress, the Think Progress is this, you know, a website putting out information, right, from the Center for American Progress. CAP, as it's known, CAP, is, it is a very centrist Democratic organization. They are from the center right even of the party. Honestly, it's why I don't have a lot of guests from the Center for American Progress on the show. I just don't, because they're just this side of third way, right? They just are not exactly a progressive think tank, as it were. But there is Ian Millhiser. I actually had him on the show not too long ago to talk about, it was the day when the Supreme Court was hearing the challenge to Obamacare, right, on which they'll rule next month. And Ian Millhiser, he's got a new book about the Supreme Court. He's good. I really like him. And as I tweeted to him yesterday after seeing what he wrote, My original tweet to him was, "Wow, I used to be a fan of yours, but seriously?" So after Bernie's announcement, Ian Millhiser let loose with a barrage of tweets. I'm going to see if I can find exactly here. So he tweeted out, sadly, the Vermont dream team of Bernie Sanders and Howard Dean cannot constitutionally be on the same ticket. Now, first of all, that's bullshit because they could, but this was just snark. And I wrote to him, really? So wait a minute. There was more. He said, let me see if I can find the other ones, because obviously these are not in order. He also said, can't wait for the Sanders versus Santorum 2016 presidential debate. And he also tweeted, Bernie Sanders probably isn't going to be president. Hashtag hot take. Really? So I saw those three. And, you know, frankly, it pissed me off. And I said, I tweeted to I. Milheiser, when representative of ostensibly progressive group, CAP, ridicules a progressive running for office, it's counterproductive. And then I said, shouldn't we be applauding someone like this? And I linked to, actually, a good piece at Think Progress titled Six Ways Bernie Sanders Will Challenge Hillary Clinton. But Ian Milheiser instead, you know, he said, you know, I said, really for, oh, he said something along the a line, I can't find it now, I guess he deleted the tweet. He said something about, I don't have much of a horse in this race or something like that. Again, that tweet seems to have been deleted. And I responded, I said, really? For not having much of a horse in this race, you're certainly spending a lot of energy demeaning Senator Sanders. To which he replied, I assure you, I spend minimum energy on my tweets. I guess, and that's when I said, when a representative of an ostensibly progressive group ridicules a progressive running for office, it's counterproductive. Zed Jelani, whom I have the greatest respect for, another journalist, he said, I don't think Ian was just making a joke. I don't think he was trying to demean Bernie. And I said, well, he made multiple jokes at Bernie's expense as he's presenting himself as a serious candidate. That's counterproductive. Yeah, I got very defensive about Bernie Sanders yesterday. And I'm there because, and I've said this before. I've talked about this, you know, that I really have a problem with the way the left, the professional left maybe, has treated Bernie Sanders over the past year. As Bernie Sanders has been saying that he would, you know, that he was considering a run and that he would run if, you know, nobody else stepped up to put forth the progressive ideas and ideals that many of us have been longing for. So, you know, Bernie Sanders, he made the rounds yesterday. I guess he did Ed Schultz's TV show, which I did not watch. He showed up on CNN. And I do want to play a little bit of that for you. Just listen to this. This is classic Bernie Sanders.
We'll have. But I do believe, and I would not have entered this race if A, I didn't think we could win, and B, if we could not raise enough money to run a strong campaign.
If there's a billionaire out there who's a liberal and likes you and wants to give you a ton of money, is that okay?
I doubt that there is. No.
Well, let's say there is. Let's say there's some George Soros type who really feels that you're best for the country.
No, I'm not going to do a super PAC. I am not supportive of a super PAC.
You wouldn't accept that kind of support?
No. No.
Really?
Well, I don't know. Maybe it was you, Wolf.
I don't have that kind of money, but you would.
Frankly, it is vulgar to me that we're having a war of billionaires. You know, Sheldon Adelson is versing the Koch brothers, versing this guy. People did not fight and die to create a democratic system where it's a war between billionaires. I will get the vast majority of my money from small individual contributions.
That's yes, he will.
That's how I do it.
And you're running as a Democrat, not as an independent.
Ah. I have a in the history of the United States Congress, I will be active in the Democratic primary process.
So he will run as a Democrat, though he still doesn't call himself a Democrat, but he will be active in the Democratic primary process. But the most important quote there was, frankly, it is vulgar to me that we're having a war of billionaires. And then he continued, people did not fight and die to create a democratic system where it's a war between billionaires. Sing it, Bernie. Oh, he did sing, by the way. There is an album that Bernie did. He sang some Woody Guthrie songs, just saying. It's not great. But it's Bernie, and we love Bernie. And look, we all know Bernie Sanders. I guess all of us except Jon Stewart. So I was, you know, defensive about my candidate, Bernie Sanders, a candidate I can believe in, somebody I will campaign for, somebody if I ever get money again, I will contribute to. So you can imagine, I got that upset over, you know, some schmuck from Center for American Progress and his snarky comments on Twitter. How do you think I felt when Jon Stewart jumped in the idiot race yesterday? Oh, my God. Now, you won't see this clip anywhere at any of the usual, you know, sites, Crooks and Liars or Raw Story or BuzzFeed. You won't see this clip. What you will see is the clip of, you know, Jon Stewart bidding a tearful farewell to Samantha Bee. And that's all well and good. I like Samantha Bee, too. And yeah, it's sad. But Jon Stewart, you know, for the last few weeks since you announced that you were going to leave, I've been sort of, you know, really upset about it. Now, maybe not so much.
You know, while the Republicans there are fat with 2016 presidential candidates, Democrats have decided to skip the primary process entirely. More of a coronation type dealy until now.
Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders has made it official. He will run for president.
Yeah!
Yeah! Gotcha! Yeah! Yeah!
Let's meet whoever Bernie Sanders is.
What? Whoever Bernie Sanders is, the longest running independent in Congress. I think he was a six-term member of the House, two-term senator, champion of progressives everywhere. And Jon Stewart does this?
No, that's Colonel Sanders. Let's meet, that's Deion Sanders. That's Ned Flanders. Sure, that's Bernie Sanders. All right, fine. So how will this, there we go.
Okay, so Jon Stewart doesn't know who Bernie Sanders is? Well, then I guess he doesn't know anything. The writers, I guess maybe The Daily Show will be in fine shape after Jon Stewart leaves, because obviously he doesn't have a fucking clue who these people are that he talks about and to. I'm livid, but oh, keep going, John.
How will this two-term senator, this eight-term representative, this full-term curmudgeon battle the incredibly powerful Clinton machine?
Let me just make a brief comment and be happy to take a few questions. We don't have an endless amount of time. I've got to get back.
Yeah, because he works.
With charm. That was his presidential campaign announcement. Not so much, yes, we can, and more like, let's just get this over with. I'm a busy man. He's basically running as the anti-Hillary. She's an establishment centrist. He's an unapologetic leftist. Her campaign is managed to a T. He forgot his comb.
Seriously? He forgot his comb?
She has almost 100% name recognition. He is somewhat lesser known.
And they have some stupid graphic up there, a dial, where nobody knows who Bernie Sanders is.
She has a private server in her home where she deleted tens of thousands of her own emails. He owns a VHS copy of Tootsie.
What? Now, I'm sorry. You know, there could be lots of jokes that Jon Stewart could make that were funny. He owns a VHS copy of Tootsie? So let's get this straight. Jon Stewart is making jokes about Bernie Sanders' appearance and his age. appearance. Can you imagine if Bernie Sanders were a woman? We're talking about Bernice Sanders here. Would Jon Stewart be talking about his, you know, hair and put up a picture of, you know, the crazy scientist guy from Back to the Future and with the hair, white hair, all disheveled and say, oh, that's Bernie. And say, oh, he forgot his comb. Or make a joke about his age. Could he do that?
I want all the media to put their hands up and swear something this election season, okay? I solemnly swear not to talk about Hillary's appearance because that is not journalism.
Just saying. You know, I get that Jon Stewart's a comedian, but my rule for making fun of much beloved figures, make that figures that I love, is much the same as my rule for jokes that could be deemed offensive. Because I find Jon Stewart's take on Bernie Sanders offensive and lazy, because there were things you could joke about. I mean, the fact that that Bernie Sanders will stop at nothing as he fights for single-payer healthcare or Medicare for all, as he fights to overturn Citizens United and get money out of politics. After all, I mean, that clip I just played from his interview on CNN yesterday is him saying, I will not have a super PAC. I don't believe in it. I find it vulgar. His fight against the so-called expansion of so-called free trade. His fight to combat climate change, his fight to not only not cut Social Security, but expand it, his fight to spend more on infrastructure and less on defense, his fight to raise the minimum wage a lot, his fight for immigration reform, his fight on labeling, requiring labels on GMO foods, on gun control, on more funding for higher education, on less foreign policy intervention, on stopping the NSA's out of control surveillance, supporting abortion rights and same-sex marriage and net neutrality. I mean, it goes on and on. Bernie Sanders has been on the right side of every fucking issue, and you, Jon Stewart, make bad jokes about him. I could forgive you if they were funny, but this.
She has a private server in her home where she deleted tens of thousands of her own emails. He owns a VHS copy of Tootsie.
Is not funny. Not funny. Someone want to explain it to me?
He has a set of consistent principles.
Yeah, he does.
That he has run on his entire political life.
Finally.
She is going to crush him.
Gee, that's really helpful. Now, Jon Stewart, I know it's not your job to be helpful, but it pisses me off when progressives and Jon Stewart, since the bullshit, rally to restore sanity and or hope or whatever it was called, that was his bullshit attempt at bipartisanship. And, you know, when that went nowhere, look, Jon Stewart has embraced, or seems to have anyway, his inner progressive. Until now, I got to tell you, I'm usually a fan of Jon Stewart's. This pissed me off. Now, that's Jon Stewart. Yes, a Republican. I wonder what a reasonable Republican thinks of Bernie Sanders and his stance on a lot of issues. You see, because I've said this before, I think there's a lot of common ground when it comes to, conservative Republicans and progressive Democrats. So, we're starting a new segment. Actually, my friend Jon LeBoutillier joined us last Monday on the program, and now he'll be with us Friday mornings to try to do things a little differently, to show where there is common ground and show, I guess, that not all Republicans are evil. Jon LeBoutillier and I met back in the 80s, seriously, at WMCA in New York. And I hope I'm calling the right number. I might not be. We'll find out in a second. Maybe I need to call the other number. You know, this is... All right, I'm going to try the other number. Because, you know, I can. All right, Jon LeBoutillier, where are you? Anyway, so we met back in... I think I called the wrong one. Let's try this one. I don't know which one I just called. Oh, I did call the wrong. Okay. So now we're calling the other number. So back in the early 80s, when I was a producer at WMCA in New York, and he was a guest host.
Hello.
Hello, Jon LeBoutillier. Good morning.
Hello, Nicole Sandler. Good morning to you.
So, Jon, for those who didn't hear our conversation last Monday, a bit of a brief reintroduction. You and I met back in the early 80s. I was a young baby producer at WMCA in New York. You were a newly ousted congressman who then found a new life in the media. You guest hosted for Bob Grant and Barry Gray at WMCA. And then... actually, you're the one who introduced me to Jim Kerr at WPLJ, thus catapulting my career into music radio for a time. So I guess it's all your
there
fault.
You
it's all your fault.
No, but I'm so happy it was good for you that it helped you, because I always thought you're the best person, Nicole.
Aww.
Even though we agree on nothing, we get along great and still do 30 plus years later.
Yes. I know. And look, we reconnected. Well, yeah, I think it is. 89. It's more than 30. Because I was at WMCA from 81 to 85. So I left WMCA in 1985, 30 years ago. Look at that.
Yeah. Okay. So there we go. 30 years.
So we're old. Aside from us being old. yeah. And then, you know.
By the way, your listeners need to know something.
Yes.
Because radio doesn't say that Nicole Sandler is one of the most attractive women ever. She's so attractive, sexy, funny. Earthy.
Well, you knew. Then again, you knew me 30 years ago. So, and we are on YouTube, by the way. I just have a picture of you sitting on. It looks like a porch chair.
Right, taken by my sister.
You're a Long Island estate, because you know you are from the old money, Jon LeBoutillier. So anyway, and we reconnected again, and we have a few times over the years we've talked, and then we, don't talk. But I heard you a few weeks ago on with my pal John Fugelsang on his Sirius XM show on Insight, and the minute I heard your voice, it's like I know that guy, and it was such a great conversation between you and my buddy John, and I thought, you know what, I need to get LeBoutillier back on the show, because there are things, there are issues on which you, a conservative, and I, a liberal, I think have common ground. And I also want to point out that as today's look, when I knew you back in the early 80s, you were like the most right wing, crazy right wing former congressman. Like, we talk about right wing nut jobs, and there are plenty of them out there. And all you have to do is look, for instance, at the Tea Party caucus of the House of Representatives, or the 2016 Republican presidential hopefuls to find crazy. And you seem to, I think you're probably right where you were, but the party has moved into crazy town and left you behind.
Well, the only thing I'll say is I don't really think back then I was crazy. I think I had a lot of rhetoric. I was very high profile in the media, and I specialized at saying things with humor that were very inflammatory. The biggest one of which I said the Speaker of the House, Tip O'Neill, and the federal government are just the same. They're both big, fat, and out of control.
Ooh.
And that got a lot of laughs. But my voting record and my politics have not changed. And I was not a crazy right-wing guy, but I am a conservative, and I can defend my positions and defend conservatism, which none of these guys can at all. And half of them aren't really conservative. They conservatism has great distrust and skepticism of federal power. But these so-called conservatives want to use federal power to get into your bedroom and into your married life and everything else. I don't want to do that. I'm a real conservative. I don't want to know what you do. I don't care what you do. As long as it doesn't hurt other people, I don't give a damn.
Well, that makes sense. So when did the Republican Party become about monitoring who you sleep with? You know,
It happened around the late 70s, early 80s. You have Jimmy Carter getting elected in 76, sort of our first born-again president, where the born-again evangelicals had become a large factor in that election, and they went for Jimmy Carter. But 4 years of Carter drove them over to the Republicans, and they move into the Republican Party in 80. They support Reagan. Once Reagan's in there, they really start moving inside the GOP. You have the rise of Jerry Falwell and these televangelists, and that religious right, as it's called, became almost the dominant player in the GOP. And when they did that, they reshaped our social issues. Reagan had been pro-choice as governor of California. He had to be pro-life in order to be the Republican nominee. George H.W. Bush had to do a 180 by 1980, interestingly, to be acceptable as the running mate. And that has been the case now for 35 years. The religious right is the base of the GOP, and you can't go against them if you want to be nominated.
Right. Right. And so we see, you know, for instance, let's just look at the last presidential race, John. You had Mitt Romney, who the guy who ran in the primary was unrecognizable.
Right.
So you see these people are so disingenuous. They're saying what they think they need to say in order to get through the primary process. Then once they get through the primary process, then they do a complete 180 to be attractive to the more moderate general electorate who doesn't pay attention to the political process except when we're coming up on a presidential election.
Well, it doesn't work, though, because once they've taken these positions, didn't work with Romney, didn't work with any of them.
Mm-hmm.
They can't do a 180. You don't have enough time, and the opponent won't let you do a 180.
Right.
If you do the 180, you lose the base of your party. Now, in both 08 and 2012, the Republican nominee, of course, they lost in the general. I've read this, and Pat Cadell on my show on Fox says it's true. There are apparently 3.5 million white evangelical registered Republicans who didn't vote in November 2012.
Oh, because Mitt was a Mormon?
Maybe, but then the same number apparently in 2008 didn't vote.
Well, because, you know, who can blame them?
Well, but here's my point is something is fracturing the GOP. Where these people aren't voting, well, they are registering to vote,
mm-hmm.
which means they want to vote, but then they see what the nominee is, and they go, screw it. I'm not going to bother going to vote. I don't like the guy, and I'm not going to go out to vote against.
Yes.
This has to change.
And can I tell you something?
To win.
And here's what I think is going to happen, and I could be wrong, again, because I'm thinking like a lot of Democrats. If Hillary is the nominee, and I'm not so convinced she will be, because there's a lot of time between now and, say, a year from now when we head into convention season. and look, she's being attacked left, right, and in between. I don't know that she can survive this. And I do know that people like me, you know, we call ourselves the Elizabeth Warren wing of the Democratic Party. Well, now I think we need to change that and call ourselves the Bernie Sanders wing of the Democratic Party.
No, that's a shame.
What's a shame?
I say it's a shame because he can't win and Elizabeth Warren could win. Could beat Hillary.
I think Elizabeth Warren could. And I think if the media would stop making fun of Bernie Sanders and treat him like the serious candidate he is and just take him on his issues, he could win.
Well,
when you have a Jon Stewart going off on his, you know, oh, he didn't bring a comb and nobody knows who he is, that's really counterproductive. I mean, I'm so sick of the media making fun of him. And it's not anything new. It didn't just happen now. In fact, I played the Jon Stewart from last night that so pissed me off. But even, you know, back in 2010, and I'm guessing we were probably on the same side of this as well. We're going into the lame duck session in 2010 after the Democrats got slaughtered, right, in the midterm elections. And it was the Tea Party wave, and right? And so,
anti-Obamacare.
Oh, my God. Well, it's whatever. Whatever you want to put
it's not whatever.
Okay.
Nicole, it was you guys.
Well,
both.
Yeah, I
you've
get
lost
right.
Both houses of Congress because of Obamacare.
Okay, let me correct you on one thing. Don't lump me with the Democrats, because although I'm registered as
Democrats
a Democrat, I am a Democrat only so I can vote in the primaries. I am not a fan of this party. And the reason I'm not is they think the way to win is become more like the Republicans because the Republicans picked up these seats. Well, no. And the reason that the Democrats have lost so many races since then is because they run the Republican light candidate. I can talk about here in Florida. They ran Charlie Crist against Rick Scott. Well, Charlie Crist is a fucking Republican. Give me a break. If we had nominated Nan Rich, who was the real progressive, then she could have taken on Rick Scott and won. People like me want to vote for someone, not vote against someone. And that's why I'm thrilled that Bernie Sanders is running. I wish Elizabeth Warren would run. And I'm bummed that she isn't, but I think we've got to take, look, Bernie Sanders believes in everything I believe in. And if he could get his message out without the media poo-pooing him, oh, he can never win. Oh, he's a nutty professor. Oh my God, his hair is disheveled. Oh my God, he's gruff and brusque. Well, you know what? That's what we need right now. Someone who's not going to lie. Someone who's not going to, you know, say what he thinks people want to hear so he can get some contributions and maybe win a primary or two. He's a straight shooter, and his message is spot on. It's exactly what we need today.
Right. Well, look, here's the thing. I have no horse in the race. I am just analyzing it objectively. I'm not obviously in the Democratic Party.
Right.
I believe this, though. As a candidate, Elizabeth Warren is a pretty damn good political candidate. I don't think Bernie Sanders is a great candidate. I think that, first of all, being a woman running against Hillary diffuses that whole argument about the first woman president. So that's why Warren is so perfectly set up. She would win Iowa, and Sanders will do well in Iowa, no question about it.
Mm-hmm.
But New Hampshire, being the next door neighboring senator from Massachusetts, she's very well known in New Hampshire, as is Sanders from Vermont. But she's very popular in New Hampshire. They know her. And
mm-hmm.
I've got polling that Doug Schoen did that she is within single digits of Hillary in both Iowa and New Hampshire. And that's before all this stuff about the foundation and the emails
right.
came out. Hey,
John,
a couple months ago.
John, I need to jump in and interrupt because we have breaking news. The state's attorney in Maryland, Mosby is her name, announced Freddie Gray's death was a homicide. Investigation has led us to believe that we have probable cause to file criminal charges.
So the question is, who did it?
Who? Right. And there were apparently six cops involved in this. I wonder if they're going to charge all six of them, because we don't know what happened. We just now find, we'll talk about a way to just change gears in the middle of a sentence. But what we found out early this morning was there was yet another stop. That van made another stop that the cops who were transporting Freddie Gray didn't divulge, but a private security camera at somewhere in the neighborhood got images of this van at I think it was a fourth stop. I think it was the second one, actually. We don't know what went on there, but we do know there was another stop. That means the cops were lying about something. And obviously now the state's attorney says they have probable cause There will be criminal charges announced.
The lying and the BS, unbelievable, because the first thing they put out was the idea that he did this to himself. Now, sadly, I have an older brother who is a quadriplegic who broke his neck in an accident 26 years ago.
Right, and what I said to you is my father lived the last 12 years of his life as a quadriplegic after somebody in his office pushed him. My father was firing this guy. My father had a nasty temper on him. And I'm sure he said a few choice words. He was firing the kid. The kid said, pay me now. My dad said, you'll get paid on payday. The kid pushed him. My father went down hard over a partition in the office, hit his head on a desk, went down, spinal cord injury. And what I explained to the listeners the other day, his spinal cord was merely bruised, and he lived out the rest of his life as a quadriplegic. Freddie Gray's spinal cord was 80% severed. To have that kind of an injury, you don't do that to yourself.
Well, you couldn't do any of these spinal injuries to yourself. And that's why when they put that out, that was crazy, and told me right away they're covering something
up. That's right.
And then the charge that the guy in the van with them, who's now being interviewed on MSNBC all the time.
Oh, my God.
Young guy.
Guy's a little
that he saw this
manic.
And that, and the Washington Post prints a story based on what this guy allegedly said.
Oh, my
said,
God.
And
that...
when you actually see the guy, he didn't say any of it.
No.
So this thing, among the things that ought to be indicted, along with the actual people who did this to Mr. Gray, the media ought to be indicted for putting out false stuff.
Absolutely. You know, say that again. The media ought to be indicted on so many different levels. You know, back when in the 80s, journalism was a real thing. You know, newspapers had investigative journalists on staff who did actual, you know, work. They did research. They did investigations. They fact-checked. And today, they're merely stenographers. It seems like they're so lazy. And I won't say it's the journalists. I'll say it's the news industry that's been so consolidated and it's no longer objective. Now, I don't know why the Washington Post published this piece. When I saw the interview with the guy who was in that van, I couldn't understand what the hell he was saying because he was all over the place. How they got out of that he said, Freddie Gray was trying to injure himself, is insane.
Yeah, the whole thing is sickening.
Yep.
And,
Well, now they're saying more.
I'm glad this lady is on. I'm watching her with the sound off. She looks like a no-nonsense. Both her parents were police officers in Boston. So
It says Lieutenant Rice, Officer Miller, and Officer Nero illegally arrested Mr. Gray, she said. The knife in his pocket was legal under Maryland law, so the officer failed to establish probable cause to arrest him. The arrest was illegal. Oh, this, you know what? This is exactly what needed to happen, and I don't know why it's taken so long for criminal charges to be filed against one of these cops who has killed now apparently an unarmed black man because the knife he had was so small that it was legal.
Right. And by the way, can I, in the few minutes we have left together today,
please,
which I enjoy totally, we're going to do this regularly.
Yes,
although
we are.
Next Friday, we got to change the time because I have an appointment next Friday, but
We'll
worry about that off the air.
Okay.
There's another legal proceeding going on today that's in my bailiwick of politics. I'm very excited about it. I'm a Republican. I've never understood, Nicole, the fascination with Chris Christie. I think he's a nasty, arrogant jerk, and he treats voters and citizens that he's supposed to serve, he treats them like chattel. And I've just never understood why the media fawns over this guy. In 10 minutes, we are going to begin to unravel Chris Christie, because David Weilstein at 11 o'clock is pleading guilty and is a cooperating witness now with the U.S. attorney. He's in court now, but the proceeding begins in 10 minutes. And then at 1 o'clock today, the U.S. attorney, Paul Fishman, having a press conference where they say he's going to announce indictments of other associates of Chris Christie.
Wow.
Which means the circle is tightening. The end is coming. And I couldn't be happier.
Good. I couldn't either. I think Chris Christie is a blowhard. He is the definition of the dictionary definition of
asshole.
He's an asshole. He just is. He is the perfect example. And hopefully this, I don't think he has a shot in hell of getting the Republican nomination. That said, I got to ask you this, because I'm down here in Florida. I've been back here for about 10 years now. My, how time flies when our brains are fried by the humidity. And I've watched Marco Rubio go from a twerp in the Florida House of Representatives to a twerp in the U.S. Senate, and now he's considered a front runner. There's no there. And the same people who are embracing him are the same ones who said that Barack Obama was too young, inexperienced.
I know.
Right?
You know, I watched Charles Krauthammer on the round table every night on Fox. And when Ted Cruz was announcing a month ago, he goes, he said, he's the same as Obama, first-term senator who's never run anything.
Yeah.
We can't go down that road again. And I am yelling at the TV saying, well, what about your boy Rubio?
Hello?
Same thing.
So who do you think?
The hypocrisy of these two.
Looking at and there's a lot of choices on the right, unlike on the left. Who do you like in this, that's piled into the clown car so far?
Well, I'm not really for any of them at the moment. I'm watching them all. There are people I don't like. I would never vote for any Bush for anything because they're liars. So that's out. I'm not really in. And I do analysis on TV, so I don't really want to take a position for or against any of the others. My position against the Bushes is not really political. It's a moral one because of what the father did on the POW issue. And I could never stand these people. They
right.
lie
and,
all the
you
time.
Know, I do want to mention that because look, Jon LeBoutillier, again, a pundit. You can find him on Fox Sunday nights. A lot of my listeners, just so you know, their TVs don't go to Fox. It's just a physical impossibility. But you are on Fox Sunday nights at 7:30 with Political Insiders. You're the author of a couple of books, including Harvard Hates America. But you've done a lot of work. In fact, I think, a lot of your efforts were placed in the Vietnam POW issue. And it should be noted that this week marks the anniversary of the fall of Saigon.
Which you don't remember because you weren't alive, but I do remember.
Yeah, I was alive.
Well, you don't remember it. You're
a little
really.
Girl. I was a kid.
And
yep.
you were probably as cute as a little Aww. Girl as could be. Aww. But it was an unbelievable day. It was yesterday. It was April 30th.
Yeah.
And anyway, that war, the whole war was just the worst war in American history, other than the Civil War, which was really incredibly bad.
And what about Iraq?
Terrible. See, that's why another reason I hate the Bushes is they phonied up evidence, cherry-picked evidence to make the case that they wanted to justify going into Iraq. The reason was really to pay back Saddam for trying to kill
his dad,
former President Bush in Kuwait on an airplane.
Yep.
So.
Yep. By the way,
when George W. Bush, Nicole, was lobbying members of Congress in the fall of 2002 to vote for the authorization for the use of force in Iraq. Now, this is 1 year after 9/11, and he's got this vote coming up in the House and Senate. And he would have members of the House come over. Republicans are running the House, but he's having them come over, and he would lobby them. And what he would say to them is, well, Saddam has weapons of mass destruction. He used them on his own people. He gassed the Kurds. He went after his own people. And besides, he tried to kill my dad.
Yep. And I can get some money from my pal, my boss, Dick Cheney's Halliburton, too, while we're at it.
when a president personalizes policy like that, it's not good. It's not good. You know? And the whole thing was bad, and they pushed it. They got away with it because of 9/11. It should be the end of Hillary Clinton because she admitted years after voting for this thing, because it was the political move at the time, She admitted she never bothered to read the intelligence on this thing, which is available to all members of the House and Senate. They all just voted for this thing without really looking at what was going on. And they got us into a war, and they crippled, they killed 5,000 men. They crippled tens of thousands, yep. Brain injuries, amputations, yeah. Ruined families, drugs. I mean, are you kidding me? This is on the Bushes.
Yeah, that's right. No, it is. And look, one thing Bernie Sanders said in his statement yesterday when he was asked about Hillary and he was saying, I'm not going to go negative because he doesn't. He's never ran a negative ad in his career, which I love. But he said, look, you know, I voted against the war in Iraq. She didn't.
Yeah.
You know, that alone. I think, and we can talk about this, you know, on a future show, but I think the Democrats are really stupid by not making sure they have a plan B, as it were. I think, look, if the media will stop making fun of Bernie Sanders, I think he could be that person. If people get to hear what he stands for, I think we could have a big surprise. But, you know, again, I would love to see Elizabeth Warren jump in the race. You know, I think that would be the best thing possible.
Well, the last thing I'll leave you with is I was on a show an hour ago in New Bedford, Mass, that I'm on also every Friday morning before I come on your wonderful show.
Yeah, busy.
And Phil Paleogis is the host, and he told me today, he said, if you go by the last statement Elizabeth Warren made about running for president, he said, I think she is going to run. He said she changed a little bit and left some real wiggle room there. Mm. Now, I haven't heard it or seen it.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
I have heard her say unequivocally, I am not running.
Me too.
I'm not going
Me
to
too.
Run. And I take her at her word. Look, here's the
Me
difference. Elizabeth Warren became a senator sort of. It wasn't her goal. She was drafted. That's why I thought she could be drafted to run for president. But she has stated very clearly that she's not going to. That said, I think if Hillary Clinton implodes, which she could, you know, then all bets are off. Anything could still happen. And we still have 18 months to go.
Yeah, we've got a long way to go.
Yeah.
But it's also possible that Elizabeth Warren is watching this book and these revelations
yep.
of the Clinton Foundation. And at some point, to quote Reagan, she has it up to her keister and says, you know what? I can't sit anymore and watch this woman, Hillary, be nominated and then ruin the Democratic Party. I'm not going to stand for it, so I am going to run. You know, you never know.
Yeah.
But I can see it. She can get up in the middle
yep.
of October and say, I'm running.
Yep.
And then forget Bernie Sanders, forget Martin O'Malley, forget all that.
Oh, we've already forgotten Martin O'Malley. Because Martin O'Malley is being implicated in what's going on in Baltimore. His policing strategy, his strategy as governor of Maryland, many people are pointing a finger at him. I don't know enough about it to say if it's right or wrong, but apparently his the way he governed when it came to police matters made all of this, set the groundwork for the police brutality that we're now seeing in Baltimore, which, by the way, all six cops who were involved in this have been indicted. A warrant for the arrest of those Baltimore cops has been issued. All six of them.
Okay, well, we'll see what happens.
Yep. You know, look, I think this is what had to happen. Let them have their day in court. That's what should have happened in Ferguson. It's what should have happened in Staten Island. That's what should happen. And so anyway, at least it's a step in the right direction there. Jon LeBoutillier, find him at JonLeBout.com. I'll put links on the blog at RadioOrNot.com. And if your TV goes there, you can see Jon on the Fox so-called news channel Sunday night at 7 o'clock.
Well, my show, I might add, is the only show that is fair and balanced on Fox. The rest of them, I don't watch it either, but
and,
my show
right?
is fair and balanced.
And see, and I believe you, because I've been listening to you, and I'm going to have to, before we next meet, I will have a segment, a produced open for this segment, and I'll have to find a fun way to say you're my favorite Republican.
You get Nancy Sinatra, these boots are made for walking. Oh, that's the opening theme of my segment.
Why?
These boots are made, because that's my nickname, Boots.
Oh, I get it, even though it's spelled differently.
Yeah. You need to wise up.
Jon LeBoutillier, have a wonderful weekend. My daughter, here, I'll make us feel old. My daughter turned 16 this weekend.
Yeah, it's hard to believe.
Yeah.
Oh, hard to believe. I don't know your daughter, no. But I know you, and I'm sure she's, if she's coming out of you, she's
well,
a great
person. I adopted her, but she is coming out of me.
Doesn't matter. Okay, fine. Doesn't matter.
Yep, she is my
best.
Kid.
You're the
Thank
best,
Thank you.
Nicole.
You too. Jon LeBoutillier. Yeah. I'll talk to you later. Have
All
a great
right,
one.
Thanks.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye.
All right, well, now it's time for this.
I read the news today, oh boy.
And doesn't it figure a day we have breaking news out of Baltimore? We've got Luke Vargas at the Talk Radio News Service at talkradionews.com, and he usually talks about international things. But Luke, maybe I should tell you the breaking news out of Baltimore is all six cops that were involved in the arrest and detention, and I think they're even calling it kidnapping and murder because it's ruled a homicide of Freddie Gray. All six cops are being charged with homicide.
Yes, I've seen it just come through in the last few minutes. The news from earlier this morning is that the medical examiners had gone through the injuries that he sustained to his head, found that one of the wounds on Mr. Gray's head was the same as, I guess, a exposed screw at the back of the van. I mean, the story that police had been circulating up until today was that another gentleman who was in the van at the same time as Mr. Gray had basically said, though I guess he couldn't see over a divider, that Gray may have been trying to hurt himself by banging, you know, his body and maybe his head against the van. But again, over the past 24 hours also, we've just heard so much new evidence introduced to this. We had the private footage from some sort of security camera that showed the police stopping the van at a time when they said they didn't stop it.
Yep.
So, you know, we started to get some doubts about the stories being fed by police. And it looks like we've got sort of another episode of Serial coming to us now where, you know, who do we trust? How do people's memories change here? How much is consciously being forgotten or rearranged in testimony? It's hard to piece it all together, but you're right. The news just coming through is that the medical examiner in Baltimore has ruled the death of Freddie Gray a homicide, and we'll see what happens next.
Right, and it's looking, you know, somebody who's done a great job, he blogs at Daily Kos, and on Twitter, Sean King has just been really just on top of all of these police brutality killings, let's call them. And he just tweeted, he said, important. I'm told that at least two dozen officers who were not involved with the murder of Freddie Gray assisted in the cover-up. I think this is gonna spread. This is gonna be even bigger than we know, because the cover-up, the lies that were told, including that Washington Post piece yesterday. So, well, he did it himself, right? Hopefully, this will send shockwaves through police departments all over the country, where they have to realize that they can't get away with this stuff anymore.
I think you're right. I would predict the same thing if I had to.
I hope so.
If I had to predict.
Yep. All right. So, Luke Vargas, you're there at the UN. Is it my perception, or does it seem like with each passing day, the prospect of a nuclear deal with Iran is more and more unlikely?
It would seem to be the case. The latest from this building, one of my colleagues, Lou Charbonneau from Reuters, who actually was walking by his office yesterday talking to a colleague and peered in, and he was furiously typing away at something. Turns out it was this bombshell of an exclusive for Reuters that says that on April 20th of this month, the United Kingdom approached the United Nations panel that is in charge of sanctioning Iran and said that they had evidence that last year two Iranian firms had been engaged in what is being described as active nuclear procurement. A Guardian story has since clarified this to say they were seeking to buy uranium enrichment technology. This is, if proven, a clear violation of the UN Security Council resolutions that established sanctions on Iran. And I think what is also being highlighted by Reuters here for, you know, public interest is that no country, you know, the United States and the other members of the Security Council would have known this, you know, claim was filed by the British. This is not something that would have gotten, you know, lost in the cracks. It was, for some reason, the UN is saying because there wasn't any time to verify these claims, not included in a publicly available summary of sanctions committee, you know, investigations for the last year. But again, it's been, what, 10 days now, more than 10 days, since that claim was submitted by the British, and they haven't gone public with it. You know, the U.S., again, would have known about this. Samantha Power would have seen this language come through, so would have John Kerry, and no one has said anything. And so I guess the questions being raised now are, you know, to what extent are our countries helping to cover up these sort of incidents or allegations in pursuit of a deal? And again, I don't have any information to suggest there was a tacit, you know, a cover-up here, that the countries were purposefully not making this public. And it's worth repeating that this is just an allegation, and so the determination could have been made in Washington, look, let's investigate this, maybe we already were quietly, and when we find out something, we'll share it. But there are suspicions, you know, that there were more allegations similar to this, and if this one wasn't going to be made public, unless this document leak had occurred, how many more instances similar to that might there be?
Good question. Yeah. Meanwhile, I want to turn to Nepal, where, oh my God, there were some heartwarming stories, rescues of young people. Oh, hold on. Where's that coming from? Young people pulled from the rubble alive after 5 days. I think with each passing hour, the prospect of more of those lessens, sadly. But now, I mean, the pictures are just devastating. I can't even imagine, and things are only going to get worse, because that's what happens in the days after the tragedy, as people in remote areas can't get food or water, and can't get their medical needs tended to. The situation keeps getting worse, and that's what we're expecting now. What are the relief efforts looking like?
Well, we've been hearing from the UN over the last 48 hours or so that one of the problems that's being encountered by these relief crews is that as they push out of the capital, Kathmandu, and try to get to those probably more needier and obviously more underserved remote areas, that they are encountering protests, that they are, the UN said yesterday, a number of these aid convoys were blocked from traveling down roads. Some local populations had erected, you know, wood or tire barriers preventing these convoys from going any further. Their argument being, look, we have people who are needy right here up on that little mountain village. Don't go 50 miles down the road. You know, open up your truck now and give us something. The argument on the UN side is that one of the biggest issues still in the delivery of aid pertains to logistics, and you simply cannot have a sustainable aid operation based out of one place. You need to move assets sort of to forward operating positions, to borrow sort of a military term there, and from there then use more local couriers and other methods to get aid out. You don't just, again, have one car going to each little town and giving aid directly. And so what the UN has had to do, and you can probably very quickly see how this gets very uncomfortable for the local populations, enlist the help of the Nepalese military to basically tell these protesters to stand down. And look, this is a country where there is a longstanding frustration with the government, lots of suspicions, many of them proven, that the government has been lining its pockets for decades with international development assistance, and in so doing has denied this country the goods and infrastructure and services that they were promised. That's no clearer than in the information we've been receiving in the past day, that 5,000 schools across Nepal are completely destroyed, not just partially damaged or had one, you know, broken window, but are gone, are not usable now or ever. And you begin to see if the government in Nepal had been prioritizing any buildings to be earthquake resistant, had been using proper materials and methods in order to prevent something like this, they did not dedicate that to what I would say is one of the more important types of buildings you could ever build properly, which is schools. I spoke yesterday on the train, just as the kind of luck that exists in New York. I sat down on my commute next to a documentary filmmaker who has spent years in Nepal with an NGO. I won't name it here, but she said their executive director had flown into Nepal the day before, so I guess this is Wednesday, bringing money to the institutions and individuals that they were going to assist, and the government pocketed half of it for taxes and customs. And she said, boy, you'd think they would drop these sorts of, sort of fleecing NGOs at a time of great crisis. But in fact, you know, that practice of exorbitant fees to people trying to help out the country are continuing. You put it all together, and I think, many people would hope this would not be another Haiti, where a botched sort of aid operation or complicated aid operation drew the ire, intense scrutiny for so many reasons of the, home country and its population. We're starting to see now that at least parts of that are repeating itself in Nepal.
Oh, I can't even imagine, what it's going to be like for the next months and maybe years. Because, look, we're, I think, 4 years after the big quake hit Haiti, and things there are no better than they were really in the months following the earthquake. Many places still look like the war zone they looked like in the immediate aftermath. Ugh. I do want to ask about this, a story you title Hooray for American Ingenuity. Tesla is, widely regarded as perhaps the savior of alternative energy here in the U.S. There was a big announcement made yesterday about Tesla Energy, and are they there? What I read didn't say anything about Amazon and Jeff Bezos, but they're working together on this.
I meant only to highlight that there was sort of a surprise rocket launch by Jeff Bezos's sort of space company, and so on the same week where we've got the Russian docking vehicle tumbling to Earth, so we now can add at least one more company to the X.
Okay, because Tesla makes the announcements about the battery, and Amazon, Jeff Bezos about space tourism. But I guess Elon Musk and Tesla introduced is Tesla Energy, a suite of batteries that can power homes, businesses, and public utilities. The system consists of the Powerwall, a rechargeable lithium-ion battery system designated to store solar power and enable homes to go completely off the power grid. Plus the power back, which is directed toward businesses or public utility use. This could change everything, couldn't it?
Yes. For your listeners, this thing is about the size of a boogie board, which maybe that term places me as a New Jersey Shore kind of guy. But it would go on the wall of your garage, plug into your electric Tesla car. And one of the big things, and again, I hope I am saying this with as much grace as an energy expert would, because I've interviewed on this topic quite a lot, but the big problem with energy usage in general are the crazy spikes in usage and, by extension, the cost for energy. The idea of this battery, at least as it's being promised by Tesla, is that it would pull energy at times when there is low load on the overall power grid, probably in the middle of the night, charge up your vehicle, and then you would have essentially the vehicle itself would almost be a driving battery. You could take it to work, and then you'd plug it into one of these Tesla batteries again, and it would take energy from your car during peak demand during the middle of the day, and it would help power the business. It's sort of a way of smoothing out the demand curve and hopefully smoothing out the price curve as well. But it also conserves. These batteries would harness solar energy that is not usable at any one given time. So if you have panels on your roof, at home, or at your business that is not being used by electricity demand within the building, that would go to the battery.
Right.
So again, on so many different levels, these batteries seem to be one of the major fixes for sort of the weaknesses of the current energy model. And there's a lot of excitement. Tesla isn't just showing that this is a prototype, that it's something, hey, it's 10 years down the line. They're building the world's biggest battery factory out in the West, and they have already set a price for this. It's $3,000 for the basic model. This looks like it, I didn't see how close they are to putting this for sale, but my impression is that this is not terribly far off. And again, it's all relative, but a price tag like that is not out of the reach of businesses, particularly, you know, tech businesses out in the West, where there are Teslas sold in much higher numbers than elsewhere. I would predict seeing this thing, hitting the walls of garages and car parks before too long. This is a really big announcement, and hopefully it catches fire.
Wow. That's right. No, we don't want that. Well, that's encouraging, so we like that. All right, Luke Vargas from the UN, Talk Radio News Service at talkradionews.com. Thank you, Luke. Have a great weekend.
Thanks so much. You too.
All right, bye-bye. All right, we're going to take a break. Before we get to our Flashback Friday segment for today, which for those Canadians listening, I know we have a bunch of you from up in the Great White North. Today, we're going to go back to 1994 for an interview with and performance from Barenaked Ladies. I'll tell you a little story about it before we play it. But before we get there, I got some business to take care of, and I want to recap the news out of Baltimore, where six officers have been indicted. Arrest warrants are out. Charges ranging from like unlawful arrest and imprisonment to second-degree murder. We'll share all that with you. I'll give you all the details in just a moment. But first, this.
Tales of American Political History with Clinton Porter Hackney.
We've been talking about the fascinating life of Miss Victoria Woodhull, who filled up 88 years with just about everything she could. The year 1872 was a big year for Victoria. She began an extramarital affair with anarchist Benjamin Tucker, but the affair didn't sap all her energy. Victoria had joined the Equal Rights Party, and at their presidential convention, they nominated Victoria for president. She was the first female to be nominated for President of the United States. During the campaign, she ran into some of those pesky rules that she was taught as a child she didn't have to obey. For one, she was not yet the constitutionally required age of 35, and she didn't even have the right to vote. And then there's the deal where she couldn't have voted for herself anyway. She was in jail on Election Day for obscenity charges. This is Clinton Porter Hackney at cphackney.com.
This Mother's Day, give a gift that gives back. A crystal heart necklace or the donation of a goat from Goats for the Old Goat. It is the mother-to-mother program through goatsforthe.oldgoat.com. Your mom will love a Swarovski crystal hearts necklace made by women in South Sudan, or a certificate and photo of a goat that you can donate directly to a mother who is hungry in South Sudan. To buy mom a gift that will give it forward, visit us at www.goatsfortheoldgoat.com. Again, that's www.goatsfortheoldgoat.com.
Climate change is real. It's caused by human activity.
Senator Bernie Sanders, climate hawk, enters the 2016 presidential race.
The drought isn't the only environmental issue Southern California is facing right now.
Thanks to fossil fuels, California still has the nation's dirtiest air. New study finds most extreme heat waves are caused by global warming.
What?
Plus, Pope Francis wants the world to protect God's creation, and the right-wing Heartland Institute wants him to knock it off.
All of those knockoffs and more straight ahead. From bradblog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
Stand by for 6 minutes of independent green news, politics, analysis, and snarky comment.
Do members of the Republican Party believe in science?
No, Bernie, they do not.
Do they respect what the scientific community is telling us in climate change?
No, Bernie.
Are they going to learn from that?
They are not.
Or do they choose to be deniers?
Yes, Bernie, that last choice. This is your Green News Report. Okay, Desi Doyen, from my count, we now have six major candidates declaring to run for president
for the 2016 election.
Yep, Senator Bernie Sanders, independent of Vermont, makes it number six.
Yay!
He officially announced he is running for the Democratic presidential nomination in 2016 this week. But unlike the Republicans who have already announced their candidacies, Sanders is a climate hawk. Here he is recently on MSNBC.
Climate change is real. It's caused by human activity. It is already, as we all know, causing devastating problems. And if we don't transform our energy system away from fossil fuel, it's only going to get worse. That is not Bernie Sanders. That is what the scientific community is telling us.
So if I've got this right, on the Republican side, we've got Rand Paul, Ted Cruz, Marco Rubio, and Jeb Bush kind of, sort of, having declared their run for the nomination. Three of those Republicans are out-and-out deniers. Jeb Bush is sounding like maybe he's not a denier.
But he's still a denier because he doesn't believe in doing anything about it.
Well, there's that. And then on the Democratic side, we have Hillary Clinton, not a denier, and Bernie Sanders, who's an independent, but I guess he's going to become a Democrat now to run. Bernie Sanders, definitely not a denier. He has been actually one of the best folks in Congress fighting to take climate action amidst this climate crisis.
Yes, and it'll be interesting to see if he is just entering the race in order to push Hillary Clinton more to the left, or if he actually is going to make it through to the nomination.
Well, he says he's going to, he's in this thing to win it, but if he ends up pushing Hillary to be more of a climate hawk, I think that can only be a good thing.
Yep. Meanwhile, the planet continues to ignore politics. A new study concludes global warming is increasing the odds of extremely hot days. It's the first study to estimate how climate change is already influencing some types of extreme weather. It finds that 75% of extremely hot days worldwide can be explained by human-caused global warming.
Isn't that almost the most obvious headline ever, that hot days caused by global warming?
Yes, you would think so, but this study is the first to actually prove it. More than one in four Americans live with dirty air. That's according to the American Lung Association, which released its annual State of the Air report this week. The top seven cities for worst air quality are all in California.
Hey, we're number one.
The dirty air is caused by what you see behind me. Freeways, not only that, major roadways, ports, and also trucking centers. These are all considered pollution hotspots.
Now, it's no coincidence that pollution hotspots on the list are all areas where major industrial facilities are located. The top three most polluted are in California's oil patch around Bakersfield and Fresno, and the neighborhoods near the ports of Los Angeles and Long Beach, which combined are one of the largest ports in the world. But the cleanest air is in Bismarck, North Dakota.
Sounds nice.
Some good news. The air quality is getting slightly better in Utah. The state's oldest, most polluting coal-fired power plant has finally been shut down for good.
Aw, sad trombones.
Of course, the owners waited to shut it down until one day before new rules limiting mercury pollution took effect because they didn't want to pay to clean up the plant's operations.
So it was the EPA once again forcing a coal-fired power plant out of business.
And to stop polluting the fish.
Tyranny.
Finally, Pope Francis hosted a climate change conference at the Vatican in Rome this week in advance of his major upcoming encyclical that will call on Catholics around the world to protect creation by protecting the environment and acting on climate change as a moral responsibility. But that was just too much for the climate science deniers at the right-wing, fossil fuel-funded Heartland Institute. Some of the big stars of the anti-science denialist club traveled to Rome to, quote, dissuade Pope Francis from lending his moral authority to the politicized and unscientific climate agenda of the United Nations.
Oh, I'm sure that worked out very well. How'd it go?
They were promptly escorted out of the proceedings.
So once again, the Catholic Church doesn't want to hear the truth. I got it. Thank you for clarifying. For much more on that story and the other ones we had no time for today, please check out our website at greennews.bradblog.com. Don't forget, you can download our reports anytime via iTunes, Stitcher, or TuneIn. Find us and follow us on the Facebook and the Twitters at Green News Report. From bradblog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
And this has been your Green News Report.
And don't forget the latest edition of the Bradcast, the new daily show from Brad and Desi, airs immediately following the Nicole Sandler Show on the Radio or Not stream at radioornot.com.
Nicole Sandler with Babes Irish.
Not that I'm any great shakes or anything, but I have gotten a lot of interview asks, but
It's like, and I've turned most of them down just because of running around and being tired. But when you ask, I want to talk to you, because you always do the best radio. And I'm just, thank you so much for having me on. It's my privilege.
The Nicole Sandler Show, weekdays 10 to noon on RadioOrNot.com.
All right, it is Friday, and what we usually do on Fridays is we segue gently into the weekend by digging into my massive archives from my music radio days for what we call Flashback Friday, and we'll do that in a few minutes. Today we're going to go back to September of 1994 with the Barenaked Ladies. It was a fascinating time, too, because I'd never heard of Barenaked Ladies, and we started, the station launched in July of 94, and we were immediately hit with a ton of phone calls, constant phone calls and faxes back in those days, requests for Barenaked Ladies. The rest, as they say, is history. So we'll get to that in just a little while. But first, I do want to go back to the breaking news. The big news story today is the state's attorney in Maryland announced charges. The six police officers who were involved in the arrest and transportation of Freddie Gray that led to his death by, an 80% severing of his spinal cord. Those six cops have been charged with various degrees of severity. Let me share this with you, because there's a photograph of the page from the state's attorney's office with the charges for each of these police officers. Officer Cesar R. Goodson Jr., charged with second degree depraved heart murder. A depraved heart. Wow. Could pull in a 30-year sentence. That's the number, the sentencing that I'll give you is the maximum penalty. So officer, the first cop, Cesar Goodson, second degree depraved heart murder with 30 years, manslaughter involuntary, 10 years, assault second degree, 10 years, manslaughter by vehicle, gross negligence, 10 years, manslaughter by vehicle, criminal negligence, 3 years, and misconduct in office, an Eighth Amendment violation. It doesn't give you a sentencing on that. Second officer, William G. Porter, charged with manslaughter involuntary with a possible 10-year sentence, assault in the second degree, and misconduct in office. Lieutenant Brian W. Rice, charged with manslaughter involuntary, assault second degree, another assault second degree charge, and two charges of misconduct in office and one charge of false imprisonment. Officer Edward M. Nero, charged with two counts of assault in the second degree, two counts of misconduct in office, and one count of false imprisonment. Officer Garrett E. Miller, two charges of assault in second degree, two charges of misconduct in office, one charge of false imprisonment. And finally, Sergeant Alicia D. White, charged with involuntary manslaughter, assault in the second degree, and misconduct in office. And in the most unbelievable but not surprising comment of the day, let me see if I can't find this, because this will blow your mind. The Associated Press is reporting that the police union says, quote, six officers aren't responsible for Freddie Gray's death. We're diligent in case. I'm going to be nice and generous here and just say,
welcome to Opposite World, where in is out and up is down. Brought to you by Honorable Speaker of the House, Little Johnny Boner, and his really big gavel.
Well, and, and Republicans everywhere. Unbelievable. At least, look, there's caution. People saying, don't be so fast to congratulate Melissa Mosley, who, by the way, is apparently the youngest state's attorney in the country at 35 years old. She's only been on the job for 100 days, and she had more balls than any of the other state's attorneys in states that would not even let justice run its course and charge police officers who were responsible for the deaths of unarmed, mostly black men, let the court system run the course. Well, nobody else had the balls to do that. So good on her. All right. A couple other things I wanted to share with you before we get into the musical segment of the program. Let's see. You know, at the beginning of the show, I was really upset with Jon Stewart. But the reason is because this is sort of the proverbial straw that pisses me off. It could become a self-fulfilling prophecy if members of the media, especially those who hold themselves out as progressives, keep harping on, you know, Bernie Sanders' appearance. Oh, he's like the nutty professor or the eccentric uncle. And keep harping on that stuff instead of on his record. If they keep making fun of him instead of treating him as a legitimate, serious candidate, then he stands no chance in winning because he will be the national joke. And it will all be the fault of the media who does this. Back in December, as I was trying to talk to Jon LeBoutillier about this, but we got sidetracked. As we enter the lame duck session after the Tea Party wave of 2010, the 2010 elections, President Obama, yeah, that great progressive, cut a deal to extend the Bush tax cuts for most Americans. It was a bad, bad, bad deal. And Bernie Sanders was the only one with the balls to get up on the floor of the Senate and wage a filibuster.
Mr. President, as I think everyone knows, the President of the United States, President Obama, and the Republican leadership have reached an agreement on a very significant tax bill. In my view, the agreement that they reached is a bad deal for the American people. I think we can do better. And I am here today to take a strong stand against this bill. And I intend to tell my colleagues and the nation exactly why I am in opposition to this bill. You can call what I'm doing today whatever you want. You can call it a filibuster. You can call it a very long speech. I'm not here to set any great records or to make a spectacle. I am simply here today to take as long as I can to explain to the American people the fact that we have got to do a lot better than this agreement provides.
Yeah,
now, let me just enumerate some of the reasons that I am opposed to this agreement.
Oh, and then he went on to, for the next 8 hours, enumerate why he was opposed to that deal. Well, some 8 hours later, after he set the internet on fire, I remember that day, it was December 10th, 2010, and we were all like glued to C-SPAN. Bernie Sanders broke all kinds of records, although he wasn't trying to do that. He was pointing out what was so egregious about this deal. And some 8 hours later, here's how he wrapped it up.
Well, Madam President, let me conclude. And it has been a long day.
It was a long day.
Let me simply say that I believe the proposal that was developed by the President and the Republicans are nowhere near as good as we can achieve. I don't know that we are able ourselves to get the handful of Republicans that we need to say no to this agreement.
And no, they
but
weren't.
I do believe that if the American people stand up, and by the way, it may not just be Republicans, there may be some Democrats as well. If the American people stand up and say, we can do better than this, that we don't need to drive up the national debt by giving tax breaks to millionaires and billionaires, that if the American people are prepared to stand and we are prepared to follow them, I think we can defeat this proposal.
I think we can come up with a better proposal which better reflects the needs of the middle class and working families of our country, and for me, most importantly, the children of our country. And with that, Madam President, I would yield the floor.
And we all collectively cheered, right? And actually, the text of the Bernie Buster was published as a book, The Speech, a historic filibuster on corporate greed and the decline of our middle class. Bernie just, you know, did what we want from our elected officials. He was there, you know, sticking up for us. And how was that treated on TV that day or the next day? Well, this was from Hardball on, again, 2010, the liberal station. Here's Tweety, Chris Matthews, and Chuck Todd weighing in on the Bernie Buster.
Let's remember what the picture, and I joked with a White House staffer earlier that day. I'm like, hey, you going to give us anything on this Clinton-Obama meeting? Because other than that, I got about 8 hours of Bernie Sanders tape to start running on air, you know, sort of half kidding, half joking.
Half kidding, and then, half joking.
You know, they bring out the big dog. Elvis comes into the building.
Oh,
and guess what? Bernie
Clinton.
Sanders, his show ended up getting put on
Elvis
back,
Trump's
on page four.
Ben and Jerry's. Here's our president.
Elvis Trump's Ben and Jerry's? Hey, Tweety, fuck you too. So you got Chuck Todd and Tweety Matthews, you know, just writing Bernie Sanders off as Ben and Jerry's. Fuck you. I'll say it again. Fuck you long, fuck you hard. Figuratively speaking, I'm not advocating for rape. Speaking of rape, I got to talk about this for a moment. The NFL draft began last night. And just shy of a week, 1 week ago today, you know, we didn't do a musical Flashback Friday segment last Friday because Amy Ziering, the producer of the new documentary, The Hunting Ground, about rape, the epidemic of sexual assault on college campuses, was with us live. The Hunting Ground, a movie you must see. About probably two-thirds of the way through the movie, we meet a young woman. We learn her name, Erica Kinsman, and she talks about being raped at her college, Florida State University in Tallahassee. She was drugged at a frat party and raped. She did not know her attacker. Some weeks later, she's in class, and this young, strapping young man, star of the Florida State University football team, walks into her classroom, and she recognizes him as her rapist. It's Jameis Winston. There are so many accounts. You know, just Google Jameis Winston rape. Watch The Hunting Ground. I have no doubt that Erica Kinsman was telling the truth. Yet she was run out of Tallahassee on that proverbial rail while Jameis Winston was the number one pick in the NFL draft last night. To make matters worse, as someone who lives in Florida, he was drafted by the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. So we have to keep this rapist. We have him in our state still. Disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. So there's that. On a happier note, this weekend I'm off to the beach. We're celebrating Allison's sweet 16. Amazing how time flies. Well, today, let's just do it, shall we? Without waiting any longer, let's get into weekend mode, shall we?
Welcome to the cavernous vault of Nicole Sandler's radio archives. Each Friday, we end the week with past interviews of musical guests and live performances. I say past, you see, because these archives are from the salad days of Nicole Sandler's career, before the reckless annihilation of a once-thriving broadcasting industry. So won't you join us now, your forever humble servant, for Nicole Sandler's Flashback Friday?
All right. Today we go back to 1994. It was actually September 15th, 1994. The station, KSCA, FM 101.9 in Los Angeles, had only been on the air a few months. And we were inundated in those early days with requests for a band out of Canada who, you know, we hadn't heard of down here, but they were huge in Canada, Barenaked Ladies. Sure enough, the first song we played by them was the wonderful If I Had $1 Million. Of course, as adjusted for inflation today, we'd have to say If I Had $10 Million, I'd be rich. Barenaked Ladies became such a favorite of the station that that year they played at our FM 101.9 Unwrapped, our Big Toys for Tots benefit Christmas show. I have pictures from that Christmas show somewhere, but not yet scanned and on my computer. So you'll have to bear with just some Barenaked Lady graphics on the YouTube. But you will enjoy, I hope, my interview with the Barenaked Ladies from September 15th, 1994. Somebody was late to start the tape going. So I missed the beginning, but I think I just introduced the guys and they launched into their first song. So take it away, Barenaked Ladies on Flashback Friday, on Radio or Not.
You're in an all-girl band. Your futon sank in hand. Understand you don't care. I have a job in a shop. I'm an undercover cop. I make sure the customers are thieves. Old at being young, young at being old. Everything's on hold within our evolution. You're my alternative girlfriend. Love you, now you cannot pretend. There's nothing left that won't cross over. Last night we slept on the lawn. You woke up and I was gone. Back to the dream I dreamed to leave. My life with her is a bore, a worn-out metaphor. No more surprises up his sleeve. Old and being young, young at being old. Everything's been sold to others. Revolutions, you're my alternative girlfriend. I love you, now you cannot pretend. There's nothing left that won't cross over. So we can get out of this town, 'cause it makes me sick. You're my alternative girlfriend. I love you, now you can
Ladies live in the Music Hall at FM 101.9. Now, do you have to pay the NAC a little royalty for the My Sharona reference?
We're hoping that they're not listening today. We forgot we were here and
we didn't say that.
Got into this.
Okay.
That's actually a Weird Al Yankovic.
That's right. That was My Bologna we were playing. Uh-huh. See, people get those two confused a lot.
Barenaked Ladies are in town. You just kicked off the U.S. tour. Is that
last night was our first date on our U.S. tour in San Juan Capistrano. We did the Coach House.
Right, and we got some wonderful reviews from listeners spontaneously on the phone this morning.
Cool.
Tonight you head up to the Ventura Concert Theater.
Mm-hmm.
When I guess I'm going to bring you on stage tonight.
Oh, okay. Right.
And then tomorrow night it's the House of Blues.
Yes.
So kind of residency.
We're going to be doing kind of a blues kind of thing tomorrow.
Are you?
Yeah. We started as a blues band back in the 30s. Kind of an acoustic Delta blues kind of thing. We taught Led Zeppelin everything they knew about the blues. Didn't seem to help though, did it? There's a lady who's short.
Who writes the music? How does that happen?
Jimmy Page.
Yeah.
And Robert.
Marvin Gaye comes to us in a dream.
Members of America.
It's the bulk of the writing got done by Steve and I for a long time, but this last, the new record, Maybe You Should Drive, most of it was written by Steve. I had a hand or a full body in four of the songs, and Steve had seven of the others, and Andy had one.
And but the thing that happens is I usually come to the band with a song just played on acoustic guitar, and everybody kind of makes their parts around it. This time around, I had demoed a lot of the songs at home on, you know, drum machine and that kind of with guitar parts, and I really just did it for fun, just because it was a cool thing to do. But that I think in some ways kind of changed the way people arrange their own parts, but it took, I think, a little bit longer to make the songs everybody their own, but people kind of write their own parts around the song.
Now, are you the lyricist?
Yeah, I usually write most of the lyrics, but Ed, you know, we kind of sing the songs that we write.
Uh-huh. Like the Indigo Girls.
Yeah, exactly.
I drum the parts that I write as well.
Yeah.
Except for the drum machine parts. You see, Steve has his Bon Tempe organ.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of. So all my parts in the album sound exactly like the Roomba beat from the Bon Tempe.
Well, you guys are. You're not from here. You're not from these parts.
You can tell, can you?
Yeah. It's the accent. Yeah. You're Canadian.
It's the oot and a boot thing they always make fun of us for.
There's a bunch of really talented musicians that come out of Canada, and you guys are huge in Canada. You're like mega stars.
Yes, we're giants.
And, you know, didn't get a lot of airplay in Southern California. When this radio station signed on the air, there were some, like, militant fans who would call, in fact, play Barenaked Ladies. And now, do you finally feel like you're starting to get some of the recognition in the States?
It's very nice. People are raving about this radio station around here. They're going, wow, we finally got a radio station that plays all this kind of music we like. So that's really cool. It's nice to make any kind of headway for us. I think a lot of our success up to this point has been strictly word of mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And we haven't had a lot of media support here in the U.S., so it's been largely grinding and touring by us that's gotten us
to
where
we are.
So
you know, we go play a town and play to 200 people or something, and then we'd come back and play to 400, and then come back and play to 600, and it's mostly been word of mouth.
Well, critically, you guys are very well received. I mean, the critics adore you, and because the music, first of all, your music is wonderful. The harmonies are great. It's great music, and the lyrics are intelligent and funny and clever. Is that what you set out to do, to be humorously musical?
I think actually we probably did start trying to be. It sounds like someone's filling up their tires around here. You filling up your bike tires over there?
Well, I got pumps, my shoes.
Oh, okay, actually, those are the pumps.
My Tevas are pumped.
Filling up your pumps.
Yeah.
I think Ed and I started off the group trying to kind of just entertain each other and ourselves. So we wrote a lot of the songs to try to make each other laugh. As time's gone on, I think things... we've been trying to entertain the five of us, and some of that is through humor, some of it is through kind of
nudity.
Nudity. Some of it is through the musical experimenting we do, and myself, I think I just like to write lyrics that that I would have liked to have heard, that I do like to hear, that I'm not embarrassed to sing. I think we just try and be ourselves and get that across.
But in trying to entertain each other, you know, after about an 11-hour bus ride, the only thing that's going to entertain you is a naked guy running around on the bus.
That's true.
So will we see any of that tonight at the Ventura Theater?
Yeah, you know,
it depends how tired we are.
We might just be tired enough.
You know what I've heard about the Ventura Theater? That the days are longer and the nights are stronger than moonshine? Is that correct? Or is that the Ventura Highway?
That's on the way up to the theater. You'll see that. You'll find that out.
That's the causeway.
How about another song from Barenaked Ladies?
You'll be waiting, and it's we just found out yesterday that the Parti Québécois, who are kind of the separatist party in Quebec, swept the provincial election yesterday. So who knows what's going to happen to our home Canada in the next year or so. So this song is for Quebec. As we walk together through the autumn, nearing winter, through the dying leaves and trees, we call our home native land. You say you don't believe a thing I say you don't believe a thing. You say you can't believe how I don't understand, but I know you will be waiting. Oh, I know I know you will be waiting there for me. Say you cannot live with me, you need your own identity, and now here I love me on national TV. So you hate my arrogance, my smothering and sitting on the fence, but I'm afraid of the hard permits of letting you go free. But I know you will be waiting. Oh, I know you will be waiting. Oh, I know you will be waiting there for me. Fighting and that effigy alighting looks an awful lot like someone whose name I just can't quite place. And though you say it's not supposed to be me or any entity, still through the flames and smoke I see I recognize that face. But I know you will be waiting. Oh, I know. Waiting there for me.
Barenaked Ladies live in the Music Hall at FM 101.9. You have just released a brand new album. It's called Maybe You Should Drive. It's on Sire Records, Warner Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
That's your second full release.
That's
you
right.
Started with an EP back in 1988.
Yeah, that was just an indie cassette.
It went the first indie ever to go gold in Canada?
Yeah, it was kind of ridiculous.
And it was the first cassette only to go top 20 as well. So it was, yeah, it was pretty crazy.
It was just available on cassette?
Yeah, we just did it as a demo, like to send out to clubs and stuff to see if they wanted to book us and maybe send out to college radio. And people started asking for it at gigs. And then we started getting record stores calling us and saying, can we get 10 of your tapes? And they'd go instantly.
Wow.
So we started getting distribution across the country through all the record chains, and it ended up going gold.
Now, what does it mean when an album goes octuple platinum?
When 8 times platinum in Canada.
Oh, my God.
Meaning in Canada, we're Pearl Jam.
Yeah, obviously.
It'd be like one in every 25 houses has a copy of our album or something like that.
So can you walk down the streets in Canada?
No, we're shot every day.
Yeah, we can definitely walk down the streets.
There's a lot of people have the album, but a lot of people are blind in Canada.
Yeah, there's a lot of people with very bad vision.
They just don't recognize you, but they know if they...
You know, I think the thing is, most people think that I look like the guy from Barenaked Ladies. Because it's a very strange thing, and I'd hate talking about it because it feels weird, but there are so many... I used to have, like, this goatee, glasses, kind of a chunky guy. There are so many guys about, you know, in their early 20s with glasses and this goatee, kind of chunky, that just look like me. And so everybody just thinks I'm trying to look like Barenaked Ladies guy. So I never get recognized.
Wow. So now, the new album just came out. How's that doing back home?
Great.
It's actually an integer number. It's negative sales. People are returning copies of it.
Oh, really?
I just wanted to say, by the way, I've now changed my look to try and get people to start looking like this. I've had myself totally changed into Loretta Swit.
And it works.
Yeah.
Those are some hot lips you got going there.
So I'm hoping that there'll be lots of 20-something guys in Canada trying to look like Loretta Swit.
And carrying around little animals and saying, for God's sake, help the animals.
It's doing... The record went platinum in the first week at home. So
wow. Congratulations. That's great.
Thank you.
Now we have to do it here in the U.S., right?
Well, that'd be lovely.
FM 101.9 is helping us along, which is great.
Well, it's really good. You guys make wonderful music. You appear tonight at the Ventura Concert Theater,
mm-hmm.
tomorrow night at House of Blues, and when you leave here, you're going to go do a special lunchtime show for some of our listeners.
That's right.
We picked a bunch out of our listeners' club, and you're going to go have lunch with them and play for them.
All right.
Great.
That's really cool. You want to do one more for us before you leave?
Sure.
This is Life
comma.
In a Nutshell.
Thanks for having us, by the way.
1, 2, 3. When she was 3, her Barbies always did it on the first day. Now she's with me. There's never any need for them to demonstrate. She's like a baby, I'm like a cat. When we are happy, we both get fat. And still, it's never enough. It's never enough, no, it's never enough. So I don't tend to worry about the things that other people say. And I'm learning that I wouldn't want it any other way. Every pencil crayon color in the box. Her blue-green eyes compliment the burnt sienna interlock. She's at the movies, I'm on the phone. We're separated, we're never alone. But still, it's never enough. It's never enough, you know, it's never enough. So I don't tend to worry about the things that other people say. And I'm learning that I wouldn't want it any other way. Call me crazy, but it really doesn't matter. All that matters to me is she. No way would you want to change me. It's not that easy, cause my time is up on the side for me. For
So I fell down with no one there to catch me falling my eyes out. Okay, and that's why her life in a nutshell. No way would she ever wanted to change me. It's not that easy, cause my time is up and decided for me. And I don't tend to worry about the things that other people say. And I'm learning that I wouldn't want it any other way. Call me crazy, but it really doesn't matter. All that matters to me is cheese.
Barenaked Ladies, live in the Music Hall at FM 101.9. I just looked out the window here. There's a fax machine, mm-hmm. and a fax just came over, and it says, please, I caught the show at the Coach House last night. It was truly incredible, and that's all I can see is it. So.
And then it says, you know, somebody kill these guys?
This is Play Freebird.
So the raves keep coming in for Barenaked Ladies. I got one final question. I have this disc in my hand they mm-hmm. sent us. It's you need a Macintosh computer for the Barenaked Ladies. Maybe you should drive... something. It's an interactive thing.
It's
what
just
is this?
A copy. It's a copy of Space Invaders. We thought people would really enjoy
it. Frogger. It's Frogger. No, it's like you can also get it for if you have a PC. If you can stick that thing in there, and it's like this little multimedia presentation. It's got like album artwork and
people can access it through America Online. And
yeah, you can download it from America Online, and I think from CompuServe as well.
So 94. What does
it
do?
It just, it's like a little like display.
Tells
like,
all about you guys.
Yeah, it tells us. Tells about. Tells a little bit about us. Plays a little samples from
has
from our songs.
Of us and
pictures so
and
that if we see you
recipes.
Walking down the street, we know that.
Right.
You know,
we don't just look like us.
It would
we
be
are
cool
us.
To include recipes, wouldn't it?
Next there's some recipes for Molotov cocktails and for pipe bombs and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. All right, Barenaked Ladies, thank you for coming by the Music
Thanks
Hall.
For us.
Thank you for enjoy lunch with the listeners. You'll have a great time.
Well,
and
to
we'll
that.
See you tonight
hungry,
at the
so
Ventura Theater, tomorrow night at House of Blues. All right. Okay. We are Southern California's album alternative, FM 101.9. Here's Joni Mitchell.
Well, we're not going to play Joni Mitchell now. We did that a couple of weeks ago. Instead, we are done for the day, for the week. Stay tuned if you're listening on the Radio or Not stream or our tune-in channel. The Bradcast is coming up next, followed by a repeat of today's show, followed by the Bradcast. Over the weekend, now that we've had a week of Bradcasts, the week's shows, all five of my shows, all five of the Bradcasts will play in a continuous loop all weekend long. So if you missed any of them, you can catch up this weekend anytime at RadioOrNot.com or the tune-in channel, NicoleSandlerShow.com. I'm going to have to change that now that we have other shows on. As always, thank you. Thank you for listening. Great news, again, to recap out of Baltimore. It's just the first step because the six officers involved in Freddie Gray's arrest and detention and assault and murder have been charged. Indictments on six of them, I guess, and arrests imminent, if not already done. Next step, convictions. But I figured with that breaking news, I will leave you with this classic from Randy Newman. It's called Baltimore. Oh, YouTube, I got to say goodbye. Bye, YouTube. We'll see you Monday, Radio or Not.